Good evening, friends. Welcome you to the webinar of Chamber of Tax Consultants on the GST series. Today we have with us a renowned faculty, Sri Ashit Shah, who will be enlightening us on reverse charge mechanism, documentation and invoices. I don't think so he needs an introduction, but for the sake of our new participants who have not had the pleasure to listen to him, I'll just briefly introduce him. He's a partner in Shah & Savla, CA firm. He's been practicing in indirect taxes, service tax, MVAT, and now GST. He has delivered lectures on various study circles and various branches of WIRC of C Institute. He has also delivered lectures on various professional bodies such as Bombay Chartered Accountant Society, our very own Chamber of Tax Consultants, AIFTP, Sales Tax Practitioner Association. He's been providing training to corporates and on indirect taxes, on GST, service tax, VAT. He was also the chairman of our Indirect Tax Committee of our chamber for the financial year 12-13. He is also a regular contributor to the referencer published by Sales Tax Practice Association. He is also regularly contributing articles in our monthly magazine of our chamber and AIFTP and STPM also. He is also a core member of our Indirect Tax Committee, convener of Law Representation Committee of STPM. He is also managing a committee member of Indirect Tax Committee from 2009-10 till today. He is also managing committee member of Sales Tax Association of Sales Tax Practice Association Maharashtra for the last 5 years, and also convener of GST Committee of STPM, and also a member of Indirect Tax Committee of WIRC of ICAI for the financial year 16-17. With this brief introduction, I welcome him and I request our president, Ajay Singh Ji, to please present a memento to our learned speaker for today as a mark of our love and affection. Sir.
Yes, thank you.
Friends, I request us speaker Ashit Bhai Shah to please take over and enlighten us now.
A warm good evening to all of you. Reverse charge mechanism, a most important thing in the whole GST law and most controversial thing in the whole taxation regime of GST. In the service tax era, the same concept was there, reverse charge mechanism, and the same has been followed in the GST era too. But looking to the provisions which has been or the manner in which it has been introduced, it looks like that it would be very difficult to comply with it, and on the top of it, how to deal with it. In today's presentation, I definitely will try to resolve some of the thing and some of the issues which even I don't have the proper reply for that. So now let's see how the things will go in this 2 hour session. So first of all, let us try to understand what is the reverse charge mechanism. So under the reverse charge mechanism, normally a supplier is required to discharge the tax liability whenever he supplies the goods or services. But under reverse charge mechanism, person receives the goods or services, he has to require to discharge the tax liability on the same. So that means that the government wants that now we wanted to catch hold those persons or to those organized people rather than to catch hold of those small people. And that's why the concept of reverse charge mechanism has been introduced. So in this scenario, what will happen? Let's see that how it will look like. There is some problem in these slides, so I think you cannot able to view. Just a sec. So see, the topic itself has created a problem. Once I started the reverse charge mechanism, and slide doesn't go ahead. So that is also a thing that even in reverse charge also that there is a problem. So as I have told you earlier, that under reverse charge mechanism, liability to pay tax is required to be discharged by the person who receives the goods or services. And government has obtained the power that yes, this two person who receives the goods or services has to discharge the tax liability. Now, under which circumstances it has to be paid? So it says when you are importing the goods or services, or all goods or services received from unregistered person, or when certain specified goods or services, irrespective of the supplier being registered or not, then they have to discharge the tax liability. So now let's see under which situation the tax has to be discharged. Before that, let's see who has to discharge. So in the normal mechanism of levy of tax, the receiver is there, supplier is in, government is there. So under normal mechanism, what receiver will do? He will first of all make the payment to the GST, because supplier has must charge the tax at the time of issuance of invoice. So he will collect the tax from the recipient of the goods or services, and then he will discharge the tax liability at the appropriate point of time. But under reverse charge mechanism, what will happen? That whenever a supplier issues the invoice, he will not charge the tax to the receiver. So the receiver will make the payment without payment of GST to the supplier, and receiver have to pay the tax and deposit the same to the government treasury in within the appropriate period of time. So this is under the reverse charge mechanism. Now, reverse charge mechanism will be applicable to goods or services both, as the law is the combination of goods as well as the services. So the government has identified certain goods on which reverse charge mechanism would be applicable, and let's see what are those goods. First of all, the goods covered is the cashew nuts which are shelled or peeled. So naturally the supplier of the goods would be the agriculturist, and the recipient of supply would be the any registered taxable person. So that means when an agriculturist supply the cashew nuts, whether shelled or not peeled, then in that respect the person who procures this cashew nuts have to discharge the tax liability. Next category of goods is the bidi wrapper, leaves or tendu. Again here the agriculturist need not have to discharge the tax liability. Any person who procures this bidi wrapper leaves, he has to discharge the tax liability. Then next item is the tobacco leaves. Again the agriculturist will supply the tobacco leaves, and any person who is registered has to discharge the tax liability. So if you will see over here, agriculturist has been kept out of it. Only the reason is because the most of the people in India are depending on the agriculturist. When I was studying the 11th standard, at that time in the economics it was coming that 70% of the Indian population is based on the agriculture, is they are doing agricultural activity, and I think to because of that now says that agriculture need not have to be bothered, they have to be only do the agricultural activity, and therefore the person who receives these goods, you have to have to register with them and discharge the tax liability. Next item is the silk yarn. A person who manufactures the silk yarn from the raw silk or a silk worm cocoons for supply of silk yarn, that would be the supplier of the goods, and the recipient of supply would be any registered taxable person. And the next category is the supply of lottery tickets. So who is the supplier of the goods? It says state government, union territory or a local authority. And who is the recipient of supply? Lottery distributor or lottery agent. Friends, it has been always a dispute whether a lottery is a goods or not, or lottery is a service. Because lottery and there are so many High Court and Supreme Court judgment which says that lottery is not a goods, but now ultimately it has been settled it out that lottery are goods, and now here it has been covered under the goods criteria only. And now whenever a state government or a union territory or a local authority keeps the draw of the lottery, then at that point of time the liability to discharge the tax liability has been casted on to the lottery distributor or lottery agent. So these are the goods which are specified under notification number 4/2017 of the central tax rate and 4/2017 of the integrated tax rate. Friends, here we have to, whenever we are studying the GST law, previously we have to look only the service tax law or a VAT law or a excise law, but now here we have to keep it into mind three laws, or rather say I would say four law: central goods and service tax law, therein notifications are prescribed, circulars are prescribed. Then we have to keep it in mind state goods and service tax law, therein also notification is issued by the all the state government. and circulars are also issued for the sake of clarification. Then we have to also see to that the Union Territory Goods and Service Tax, UTGST, and last one is the Integrated Goods and Service Tax Law. Therein, they are issuing the notification, plus there are rate notifications are also there. So, ultimately, we have to keep it in mind, so many acts into consideration, and then have to decide whether these particular goods are covered under the CGST law, SGST law, UTGST law, or IGST law. So that's why that is very much important. So if at any point of time under one law, if something is missing, then it would be very much detrimental. We will see at one place that yes, there is some lacuna in respect of one category of exemption. Now we have seen the goods in which the reverse charge mechanism is attracted. Now let's say what are, which are the services under which the reverse charge mechanism attracts. Now, first of all, I have said specified services under the reverse charge mechanism under the when the transactions are intrastate transaction. So that means we have to also see the notification for interstate transaction also. Fortunately, the same category of services are defined under the for the intrastate as well as interstate too. Now let's go to the service part. First is the goods transport agency in respect of transportation of goods by road. So this is the services, transportation of goods by road in a goods carriage. Now who provides the services? Naturally, services are provided by the goods transport agency. Who is the receiver of the services? It says, first, any factory registered or governed by the Factories Act 1948, or any society registered under the Society Registration Act 1860, or any cooperative society established by or under any law for the time being in force, or any person registered under the GST law, or any body corporate established by or under any law, or any partnership firm or AOP, or any casual taxable person. So these seven category of entities are there. They are required to be discharged the discharge the tax liability under GST whenever they procure the services from goods transport agency. So a question will come that in the clause subclause D, it says any person registered under the GST law. So they envisage that though if any factory is registered under or governed under any law, but not registered under the GST due to any reason, then also they are covered under the this reverse charge mechanism applicable. Society, which is cooperative housing society, which is registered, that they might be not registered under the law because they may not be providing either taxable service or their total aggregate turnover of such supplies are less than 20 lakhs rupees. But then also if they avail the services of goods transport agency, probably they have to take the registration and discharge the tax liability. Then any partnership firm, if a partnership firm is not carrying out any activity of business, but then also if they avail the services, then they have to discharge the tax liability under the GST law. Now let's say whether that is rightly so or not in the next slide. Then, since this provision was there, so lot many queries has been raised initially whether these goods transport agencies are required to be registered under the law or not. So on 22nd of June 2017, the government has come out with a notification that whenever any tax person who is only engaged in making supply of taxable goods or services or both, then the total tax on which is liable to be paid under reverse charge on by basis by the recipient of such goods or services or both under subsection 3 of section 9 of the said act is the category of person exempted from obtaining the registration under the aforesaid act. That means they are envisaging that if a transporter who is only engaged in making supply of taxable goods or services or both, and the tax on that is to be discharged by the person who receives the services, then they need not have to be registered. Excellent. So that means a view has been taken that the transporter who are supplying the taxable goods or services or both, they need not have to be registered. But here one has to be very much cautious. What it says is the person who are only engaged in making supplies of taxable goods or services or both. So here the word only is making a problem. That means suppose if I am engaged in the supplying of an exempted services also, then in that respect this transporter would not be eligible to claim the benefit of this notification. This is the one of the school of thought which comes out from this definition notification, which says who are only engaged in making supply of taxable goods or services or both. So that means if a goods transport agency is getting any interest on the deposits from the deposit which has been kept before the tire manufacturing company or a petrol pump, and if they are receiving any interest, or if they have any surplus fund and that they have put it in a fixed deposit and receive the interest from that, then such interest is considered to be an exempt supply or a nil rated supply. Then in that situation, probably he cannot take the benefit of this exemption notification. The second school of thought is no. It is not like that. The intention of the government is that whenever you are providing services and the tax on which is required to be discharged by the recipient, then that person need not have to discharge the tax liability. So these are the two schools of thought is there. But in my personal view, the most eligible view would be that if you are supplying, if a goods transport agent is supplying exempted services, then definitely they won't be able to take the benefit of this notification, and they have to have registered with the service tax or with the GST authority. Second thing which I would like to put forward before you, that during the course of the business, a transporter may sell the old tires, or he may sell his truck or a motor vehicle during the course of his business transaction. So once he sells the motor vehicle or tires during the course of business, then also he is supplying taxable services. And if we see the definition of aggregate turnover, then it says aggregate turnover means all taxable supply of goods or services, including exempt supply or a non-taxable supply or a nil rated supply of goods or services. So taking this thing also into consideration, if for the time being the transporter is not registered, but the moment if he sells any taxable item of goods, then definitely he would be fall under the taxable definition, and he has to require to be registered. Another thing, that if we go to the whole list of recipient of supply, if a transporter is providing the services to an individual or a proprietorship firm, or a proprietorship firm wherein HUF is a proprietor, then in that respect also it would be difficult to say that since the supplier of the service is GTA and recipient of the supply is not covered over here, then in that case tax liability has to be discharged by whom? Whether no tax has to be payable or the tax liability has to be discharged by the goods transport agency. Obviously, that the idea is not like that, that no tax would be payable, but the tax has to be discharged by the goods transport agency. So this we have already taken into consideration when a GTA provides exempt service, that is the interest. Is the exemption applicable? No, definitely not. If they are having the interest, then this exemption will not be applicable. Then GTA provides services to individual or HUF, exemption applicable? No. Under when they are providing the services to individuals or HUF, then definitely they have to be registered, because then the tax liability has to be discharged by them. Then GTA sales trucks or tires during the course of business, exemption applicable? No, exemption would be withdrawn, and from that date onwards he has to register before the authority. Now another important thing regarding the registration, again a two school of thoughts will come into the picture. Section 22 of the SGST Act says that a person who is liable to be registered would be the person where he crosses the limit of aggregate turnover of 20 lakhs. So Section 20 provides that if the turnover in the state, if it exceeds the 20 lakhs rupees, then that person needs to obtain the registration. Section 23 provides that the following person shall not be liable to be registration, namely when a person engaged exclusively in the business of supplying goods or services or both, and that are not liable to be taxed, or they are wholly exempt from tax under this act, or under the Integrated Goods or Service Tax Act. That means two conditions must to be fulfilled. He should be either engaged exclusively in the business of supplying of goods or services, or he is not liable to be taxed, or who is wholly exempt from tax under this act or under the Integrated Goods or Service Tax Act. And number two, an agriculturist to the extent of supply of produce out of the cultivation of land. So that means section 23 is very categorically providing that if person is engaged exclusively in the business of supplying goods or services or both, are not liable to be taxed or are wholly exempt, then they need not require to be registered. And section 24, last three sections are there under the registration. And section 24 provides that notwithstanding anything contained in subsection 1 of section 22, the following categories of person shall be required to be registered under this act, and wherein it says the person who are required to pay tax under reverse charge falls under section 24. So it presupposes that when a person who is required to take discharge a tax liability under reverse charge, irrespective of their turnover, they have to be registered. So by reading the whole the section 22, 23 and 24, section 22 talks about the mandatory turnover limit, that when a turnover limit exceeds 20 lakh, then only the registration is mandatory. Section 23 talks about the situation wherein a taxable person is engaged exclusively in the business of supplying of goods or services or both, or is in the engaged in exclusively in the providing of the wholly exempt goods or services. And section 24 talks about that if section 22 is notwithstanding anything in section 22, that means irrespective the turnover is less than 20 lakh, then also if a person is has to discharge the tax liability under reverse charge, he has to discharge it irrespective of the turnover. So now the question will come up whether section 23 obviously is not applicable to section 24. So once a person is covered under section 23, he need not have to go to section 24. That is a lacuna which is over there, because a person may argue that since I am not exclusively engaged in the business of supplying goods or services or both and not liable to be taxed, that means the tax has to be paid by the recipient, then in that respect I am out of section 23. Once I am out of section, I am covered under section 23, that means I am out of the law. So I need not have to travel to section 24, because, and one more argument, that section 24 says that notwithstanding anything contained in section 22, that means 23 is not applicable to them, and accordingly under reverse charge mechanism, though I am under the reverse charge mechanism, I am covered under 23, so I will not be applicable. So now let's take an example that how it will operate. So let us take an example that a goods transport agency is providing the services to a healthcare unit, that means a hospital. Now in this situation, hospital is a private limited company. Now what would be the situation? Friends, you must be aware that healthcare services are kept under the exemption category or a nil rated tax. So healthcare services need not have to, hospitals need not have to pay the service tax because they are under the nil rated tax. So once they are under nil rated tax, section 23 will apply. It says any person engaged exclusively in the business of supplying goods or services wherein they are wholly exempt from tax, because they are wholly exempt from tax. So they will say I am covered under section 23, so I am out of the GST law. But section 24 says that if any following persons shall be required to be registered under this act, if they are required to pay tax under reverse charge. So now what would be the situation? Whether section 24 will be applicable to the hospital? Let's try to see that what the GTS provision says. Here the provision says that when a goods transport agency provides the services by goods transport agency to any body corporate established by or under any law, then in that respect the tax has to be discharged by the that body corporate. That means in our example, that hospital has to discharge the tax liability because he is covered under the body corporate. So now argument will start that whether hospital, though they are into the provision of exempt service, whether because they are availing the one single transaction of a goods transport agency, they have to register and comply the law. Friends, again there are two school of thought. One school of the law says that since a specific exemption is there under section 23, I need not have to go to section 24, and accordingly the hospital need not have to be liable to be discharged the tax liability whenever they are availing the services of goods transport agency. Another school of thought, no, it's not like that, because the government has very much thought it fit that whenever they say that any services is provided by the goods transport agency, then they have provided the whole list, irrespective of the fact whether that person is registered under the GST law or not. That means if you see clause sub A, B, C, E, F, G, though they are not registered under the GST law, then also they have been covered under the list of recipient of supply, and accordingly they have to be discharged the tax liability under the reverse charge mechanism. But friends, really, every time I read the law, a school thought comes, no, in the hospital need not have to pay the tax. Other day I will read, I thought, no, they have to pay the tax because of the law is like that. It's very, very really confusing what is to be done. Unfortunately, there is no answer in the FAQs which has been issued by the department nowadays. Every day you are having the FAQs with you, nothing is there in the FAQ. Twitter also, let's hope that the government will clarify this thing as early as possible so that this overlapping of the law should be reduced to a great extent. Otherwise, it would be very much difficult to comply with the law. So this is what as regard the services provided by a goods transport agency. Now let's go to the another service. It says representational services provided by advocate, including senior advocate before any court, tribunal or authority. It further provides that it also includes a contract for provision of such service which has been entered through another advocate or a firm of advocate, or by a form of advocate by way of a legal service to a business entity. So first of all, whenever any representational service is provided by an advocate, including a senior advocate, before any court, tribunal or authority, then in that respect, the person who receives the services, that is a business entity located in a taxable territory, have to discharge the tax liability. They have also defined the term business entity, and it says business entity is located in a taxable territory who is a litigant, applicant or petitioner as the case may be, and that shall be treated as the person who receives the legal service for the purpose of this notification. Now interestingly, this business entity is also defined under section 2 of the CGST Act, and where it says any person carrying on the business. But for the purpose of this notification, it says business entity means a entity located in the taxable territory who is a litigant, applicant or petitioner as the case may be, shall be treated as a person who receives the legal services. So that means only a whenever a representational service is provided by an individual advocate, including a senior advocate or a firm of advocate, to a business entity, then only it would be covered. So if it's not a business entity, then in that respect this reverse charge mechanism should not be applicable. But again, business entity has been defined in a very broad manner. It says it means who is a litigant, applicant or petitioner. So everybody is covered, even individual is covered within this definition. So whenever any representational services to provide anybody, it would be exempted. The view can be taken in this manner. Otherwise, they can have borrowed it from the section 2, wherein it has been says business entity is defined under part 2, and it says business entity means any person carrying on business. They have not brought forward that definition. And therefore, it appears that any representational services provided by an individual advocate or a senior advocate or a firm of advocate, they would be under the reverse charge mechanism, and business entity needs to discharge the tax liability. Now, let's see the legal services. What do you mean by the legal services? It says legal services means the services provided in relation to any advice, consultancy or assistance in any branch of law in any manner, and includes representational services. That means legal services is covered within the definition of representational services also. Now it says that it has to be, now this legal services are first of all under one thing, they are under the reverse charge mechanism as far as the representational services are concerned. If you provide any legal services, then the law says that no, they are, now you are not under the reverse charge mechanism, but such services are exempted from tax, or a nil rate of tax is provided. So which are those services? Let us see that. So it says whenever any advocate or a firm of advocate provides the legal service, that means any advice, consultancy or assistance in any branch of law, to a advocate or a firm of advocate providing legal service, for a business entity with an aggregate turnover of less than 20 lakhs or any person other than business entity, then in that respect, no tax has to be payable either by the advocate or neither by the recipient of the services. That means whenever an advocate or a firm of advocate provides the services to another advocate, it is exempt from tax. When an advocate provides the legal services to any business entity whose turnover is less than 20 lakhs rupees, it is nil rated or an exempt tax services. And any business entity, then also there is no tax. That means if you look at, then whenever legal services are provided, no tax has to be payable, but only in representational service it is taxable, and tax has to be discharged by the person who receives the services, and that is business entity. Now let's talk about the senior equidoquid. Friends, in the service tax era also this provision was that they have divided the advocate and firm of advocate and a senior advocate because the tax treatment is different. Now what will happen when a senior advocate provides the legal services? So whenever a senior advocate provides the legal services like advice, consultancy or assistant in any branch of law to a business entity with an aggregate turnover of less than 25 lakhs rupees or any person other than business entity, then also it is considered to be an exempt service and no tax needs to be payable. So here now the problem will arise that when, suppose if a senior advocate provides the legal services to an advocate or a firm of advocate, what will happen? Whether tax needs to be payable? Obvious reply is no, then need not to be payable. So that means if a senior advocate provides the services to a business entity, then in that respect probably, when a senior advocate provides the services to any business entity, representational services, then probably the tax has to be discharged under the reverse charge, and therefore they need not have to be registered also. So confusion was there, and that's why our press release has been issued on 15 July 2017, and wherein they have clarified that the senior advocates and advocates are not required to be registered under the GST law because they are providing taxable services, but the tax on which is either exempted or has to be discharged by the person other than by the recipient of the services. And next category of service is the arbitral tribunal. So whenever an arbitral tribunal provides the services to any business entity, again a business entity, we have to see, go to the definition which has been provided at part 2, suppose N of the notification number 12/2017, wherein business entity has been defined as any person carrying on business. In that respect, arbitral tribunal did not have to pay this, the GST, but only a business entity has to pay the tax on the same. Now let us understand that there is one more category of tribunal under the Christians Marriage Tribunal. So that means now what is the difference between a normal arbitral tribunal and a Christian Marriage Tribunal? So let us try to take the meaning derived out of a dictionary. So an arbitral tribunal is a panel of one or more adjudicator which is convened and sits to resolve any dispute by way of an arbitration, and this tribunal may consist of either a sole arbitrator or there may be a two or more arbitrators which might include either a chairman or an umpire. So basically an arbitral tribunal are there or a form to resolve any disputes by way of an arbitration. That means they will intervene and try to resolve the disputes between the both the parties so that they both the parties need not have to go to the court of law and waste the time of the court of law. Now let's see what do you mean by the Christian Marriage Tribunal. It says that they are formed to care for the dignity of the marriage, to work for the good of the person, and this tribunal works toward this end by diligently protecting the rights of a man and a woman in a specific marriage, as well as the right of the church which has been charged by the Christ to the guardian of the sacrament of the matrimony. That means for a limited purpose the church will come into the picture for the marriage or the tribunal, that whenever there is a dispute in the marriage, at that point of time the Christ will come into the picture. They will try to resolve the dispute in the marriages and accordingly give the judgment. So they are for a very limited purpose. Christian marriage tribunal is for a very limited purpose, and naturally they are charging for that. So in my view, this there is a totally distinction between an arbitral tribunal and Christian marriage tribunal, so that they cannot be covered within the definition of an arbitral tribunal, because it is mainly to form to resolve the disputes, and accordingly that would not be there under the reverse charge mechanism. And the fourth set of services, the sponsorship services provided to any body, corporate or partnership firm. So whenever any sponsorship services is provided to any body, corporate or a partnership firm, the tax has to be discharged under the reverse charge mechanism by a business entity. Now, many times the sponsorship services are very loosely used. Say for example, a corporate entity is there and they wanted to sponsor one event by way of putting their banner in the event which has been carried out, and they have been charged say 25,000 rupees for putting their name in the event which is organized in the convention hall. Now, can we say that this is a sponsorship or an advertisement? So there is a very thin line of demarcation between sponsorship and advertisement. In an advertisement, it is meant the charges are given only for the purpose of advertisement or the promotion of the product. In the sponsorship, there is something over and above the advertisement or branding of the product. Say for example, in a beauty contest or pageant, a Hindustan Lever says, I am sponsoring the whole event. So not only you have to put the banner in the banquet hall or a auditorium or a stadium, but you have to also name the event in, because I am sponsoring the whole event. So many times you will find that it is say Lux so and so beauty pageant or a CineStar award. Lux CineStar Award. So this all are the sponsorship, because in turn they are getting something over and above the placement of the product of the company. So there is a slight distinction between sponsorship and an advertisement. So one has to be very much careful, because when an advertisement has been provided either in a souvenir or in somewhere else, then it cannot be termed as a sponsorship, and the tax has to be discharged by the person who is exhibiting that under the forward charge mechanism. But when a sponsorship services are there, that means the person who gives the sponsorship to any body, corporate or partnership firm, then in that respect reverse charge mechanism would be attracted and a business entity have to discharge the tax liability. So it may so happen, let's say for example in a company event manager is there who they are holding and beauty pageant show, and the sponsorship has been given by an individual, then what will happen? Then the law says, then in that respect, under the forward charge, the tax liability has to be discharged, because this reverse charge is applicable only when the recipient is body corporate or a partnership firm. Next tranche of service, specified service, is the services supplied by the central government, state government, union territory or a local authority to any business entity. That means all the services provided by central government, state government, union territory or a local authority to any business entity would cover over. However, they have carved out certain four activities which would not be there under the reverse charge. Now let's see which are those four activities. First one, renting of immovable property. So whenever a central government or state government lease the immovable property, then at that point of time the tax liability has to be discharged under forward charge mechanism, and central government or a state government has to discharge the tax liability and not any business entity. Then speed post, express parcel post, etc. by the Department of Post. You must be knowing that whenever a Department of Post provides the speed post services to any business entity, then in that respect, the tax would have to be discharged by the government, by the Department of Post only, and no reverse charge mechanism is applicable. But suppose if it's an England letter or a normal postcard, then in that respect, tax needs to be discharged under the reverse charge mechanism by the business entity. Again, the word is a business entity, so that means if an individual
is availing the services of a postcard, then it won't be covered under the reverse charge mechanism. Then services in relation to aircraft or a vessel inside or outside the precincts of a port or an airport. And fourth one is the transportation of goods or passenger. So transportation of goods or passenger, then that means we Mumbaikars are using local train services. So if you are traveling by a local train, then in that respect, the tax is only levied when you are traveling through first class or an AC compartment. So that means other than a first class or an air conditioned compartment, there is no tax. It is specifically exempted. But if you are traveling with an AC or a first class, then in that respect, tax needs to be discharged under the forward charge mechanism and has to be discharged by the central government or a state government or a union territory. So friends, now whenever you are traveling through an first class in a suburban train, then at that point of time, please, whenever you are taking the railway pass, just see that whether the number has been mentioned, they have charged the GST or not. Now they have charged the GST, definitely, because in this similar provision was there under the service tax era also. But now the thing is that what will happen, whether you are eligible to take the credit of the same or not, whenever you are traveling with it in an AC compartment or in a first class compartment. Now the obvious thing is that whenever you wanted to avail the input tax credit of the tax which has been paid by you, the supplier has to put your GSTN and he has to put, also file the GSTR details of your GST in your GSTR 1 return. That means he has to take your GSTN number and upload the detail. Now in this case, do you think that our government or a say central government will take this all these details whenever you go to take the railway pass of a first class? They will ask you, are you registered? Then please give me your GSTN, I will put in and then issue a pass. Obvious reply is no. Then in that case, whatever GST you are paying, you are not eligible to take the credit of the same. So this is very lacuna, because what will happen that if you if they take it, then they have to file the GSTR 1 and in that they have to upload all this detail. Now the question is how they will do that. It's a million dollar question, how they will do it. Then the question, which tax they will levy, whether they will levy IGST or whether they will levy local tax, that means CGST and SGST. Yes, friends, what do you think? I know that this is a webinar, so I will not get the reply for that. Because in the this is the beauty of the thing, that whenever you are addressing the live audience and when we are addressing on a webinar. So, friends, here it would be very difficult to get it, because I have seen that nowadays the government is levying, whenever you are obtaining the railway pass or a railway ticket, they are simply levying IGST irrespective of the fact. Because if they have to issue the levy the local tax, then every in the each and every state they have to be registered, then and then only they can do that. I don't know what will happen, but definitely at present, for a shorter period of time, our credit will be lost. Similarly, if you are traveling through buses, AC bus, then also they will levy the GST and your credit would be lost to that extent. So the basic purpose of the seamless flow of credit would be vitiated in respect of such taxes which has been paid by it. But the question will come that it says the recipient of supply should be the business entity. So that means only the business entity, then only the forward charge would be applicable, otherwise not. So let's see what will happen. Next set of services, director services. This service is also there under the service tax regime also. So it says, who is the supplier of the services? Director of a company or a director of a body corporate. And who is the recipient of supply? Company or a body corporate. So what will happen? Now you know that in a private limited company, directors are there. And these directors would be either an executive director or a non-executive director. All executive director or a whole-time director, they can also be designated as a whole-time director. Now what will happen? Whenever an executive director is appointed at that point of time, ideally a employer-employee contract has to be entered. That means whatever benefits a
or facilities are provided at that point of time to the employee, the same contract has to be entered with the director of a company. Then they are known as an executive director, and whatever remuneration they are getting, that would be considered as an employer-employee relationship, and they are out of the GST law. But in respect of a non-executive director, they are not into taking active participation in day-to-day management of the company, and accordingly they are not there, there are no employer-employee relationship is there, and accordingly they are not getting the remuneration of that. But they have to take part in the meetings which are going to be held of the board of directors. At that point of time, they have to be present and give their views as regards the activity of the company. So the company will pay the sitting fees to this director, non-executive director. And then the question comes, what will happen to this sitting fees which has been received by the non-executive directors? Friends, undoubtedly, the services provided by this non-executive director to a director, and they are getting the sitting fees, covers within the scope of definition of supply, which has been defined under Section 7 of the CGST Act. And therefore, it would be a supply, and tax, the GST would be applicable. But here, again, it's says that the tax has to be discharged not by the director himself, but by the company itself, because it is more an organized sector, and therefore the company has to discharge the tax liability under the reverse charge mechanism. Friends, here a word of caution would be that in respect of a many corporate private limited entity, I have observed that directors are there and they are getting the remuneration, but no formal contract as employer-employee contract is entered with between the both of them. Further, they are not exposed to follow the ESIC rule or a PF rule, though for the other employee the same rules are applicable. Third thing, their basic salary are never there in the contract, and therefore depending upon the profits of the company, their remuneration is decided. And therefore a caution has to be there to all of you, all the that such kind of things would be really a detrimental, because nowadays under the service tax law, that they have issuing the notices to all the companies wherein the directors are getting the remuneration and asking whether they are the director, executive directors or non-executive director, and why the remuneration should not be attract the reverse charge mechanism. And hence it is becomes very important that there has to be a formal employer-employee agreement, and then only we can take a stand that yes, there is an employer-employee relationship, and the salary would, or a remuneration which has been given to director will not come under the reverse charge mechanism. In the absence of that, there would be a problem, definitely would be there. Next set of service is the insurance service, that means life and general insurance services. Who provides these services? Insurance agent will provide these services to an insurance company. Then in that respect, it has been said that the tax would be paid by the insurance company and not by the insurance agent. Very easy way to collect the taxes from an organized sector. If you say that how many insurance company would be there, say 15 or 20 insurance company would be there, and how many agents would be there? 20 lakhs or 2 crore agents would be there, and therefore it would be very difficult to collect the taxes from all these insurance agents, and therefore a reverse charge mechanism has been introduced, and by way of that the insurance companies had been held responsible to discharge the tax liabilities. Next is the recovery services. Banking company or a financial institution or a non-banking finance company appoints the recovery agent, because they have appointed the agents, because they have granted the loans to the businessman or an industry, and to recover that loan they have to appoint the recovery agent, and this recovery agent will be, on recovery of the loan they would be compensated by way of a remuneration. So again, here also the task has been casted on the banking company or a financial institution rather than recovery agent, and tax needs to be discharged under the reverse charge mechanism. But then also the funny part is that still the borrower from the bank are still not paying or are run away from the country, and nobody can do anything. Next set of service is the transfer or permitting the use or enjoyment of a copyright, covered under Section 13(1)(a) of the Copyright Act 1957, relating to any original, literary dramatic, musical or artistic work to a publisher, music company, producer or the like. That means this talks about the original work of the literally dramatic, musical or artistic work carried out by the publisher, music company or a producer of the like. That means whenever there is a transfer or permitting the use or enjoyment, like say for example a music composer that is there and he has composed one music, then at that point of time if the same has been sold to a music company, then in that respect the tax has to be discharged not by that music composer, but it has to be paid by the music company. But this is applicable only in respect of the copyright product. So that means when next time it has been sold, then such exemption would not be payable and it has to be applicable under the forward charge only. The next set of services, any services. So who is the supplier? Any person located in a non-taxable territory, and the recipient of supply would be any person located in the taxable territory other than non-taxable online recipient. That means now this talks about that when a person who is residing in a non-taxable territory, that means out of India, and from where the services are provided to a person who is residing in India, then in that respect, Indian person has imported the services and accordingly the reverse charge mechanism will trigger, and the person who is in the taxable territory, he has to discharge the tax liability. This provision was there even under the service tax law too. There are three queries on RCM. Can you please take after 9-4? Okay, sir, I will definitely take it out. Let me complete this and then I will take it out. So whenever that means you are importing the services, you have to discharge the tax liability. Now, if you will see it over here, these two exemptions or a specified services are notified under the Interstate Act. That means this act that has been notified under notification number 10/2017 of the integrated tax rate. So what will happen that many a times the services are provided by an aggregator of the services, then in that respect it says that in such a situation the tax liability has to be discharged by the person, by that aggregator, and he has to discharge the tax liability. So the question has come out that what will happen if that company doesn't have any person who any presence in India. Then the law says don't worry, then in that respect you have to appoint one person in India who will act on your behalf. Then that those non-taxable territory company will say no, we also don't have any presence in India, so how we will discharge the tax liability. So the government says nothing doing, you have to discharge the tax liability. For that matter you have to either appoint an agent for the purpose of discharging of the tax liability. Then next set of services, services supplied by a person located in a non-taxable territory by way of a transportation of goods by a vessel from a place outside India up to the custom stations of clearance in India. Now this would be hardly hit by all the importer. So what normally do the importer imports the goods from a country outside India and he has placed the order. So now naturally the person from whom the goods are imported, say for example he is from in Germany, and the order has been placed and the goods has been shipped from the German port and comes to the India. At that point of time vessel has been booked by a German exporter from a shipping line which is located either in Germany or from an United Kingdom or at USA. And he will say that please take these goods and deliver at my customer who is located in India. And he will either dispatch the goods on an FOB value or on FIR basis, that or a CIF basis. Now in this situation what will happen that when the goods are coming into the territory, the importer will release the goods by paying the appropriate custom duty. This custom duty is always payable on the CIF value, that means cost, insurance and freight taken into consideration and plus 1% markup, and on that basis the import duty has to be payable. And now you know that whenever you are importing the goods, on import of the goods you have to, importer has to also pay the IGST. Now further it says, this law provides that whenever an Indian importer has obtained the services from a vessel to transportation of goods, then in that respect for the transportation charges the tax needs to be discharged by the importer. So that means on the transportation charges paid to the shipping line, the Indian importer has to discharge the GST on that value. So that means what will happen, that there would be a double taxation to a certain extent. Whenever an Indian importer discharges the custom duty, at that point of time, he discharges the tax liability on cost, insurance and freight charges, which is included in that. And on that, he will pay the custom duty plus as IGST because he is importing the goods. Now the law further says that whatever transportation cost include, though that transportation cost has been borne by the foreign exporter, then also the law provides that no, you are providing that availing the services from a person who is located outside India, and in India, importer has to discharge the tax levy. So to this extent, there would be a double taxation, and the Indian importer would have to bear this cost. But of course, this would be again sandwichable, whatever tax which has been paid while importing the goods and paid the IGST, as well as on the freight which has been paid IGST. Now, the, both the things would be sandwichable, and importer can get the credit of the same. Another issue would come up that whenever the goods are imported under the, on the CIF basis, at that point of time, the foreign exporter may not write the value of a transportation charge which he has incurred. Then at that point of time, it would be very difficult to identify on which value the tax needs to be discharged. Earlier under the service tax law, they have clarified that if you don't have separately the value of transportation freight ocean freight charges, then in that respect you have an option to discharge the tax liability by considering 1.4% of the CIF value of the import, and then on that you have to discharge the service tax liability. However, such provision is missing under the GST law, so there would be a certain difficulty which would be faced by the importer when they are importing the goods under the CIF value. So these are the two services which are there under the reverse charge mechanism under the interstate transaction, because these are the import of services, import transaction, and under the IGST law, when provided that whenever there is an import of transaction, the IGST law would be it would be considered as an interstate transaction. Now let me take the three queries, online queries which has come right now. Transport cross limit of 20 lakhs, then whether he has to obtain GST number, whether transporter have to charge GST in his invoice. See, when here the transporter, whenever his turnover, that means taxable and exempted turnover, it would be like that. Because on the no, suppose if he is providing the transport services to the specified entities, this is a kind of seven services, then in that respect, he need not have to discharge the tax liability, because tax liability has to be discharged by the recipient of the supply. So whenever he makes any taxable supply, as I have mentioned in my example, that whenever he sells any tires or a truck, then at that point of time it would be a taxable supply, and at that point of time he has to take the registration number and discharge the tax liability on only on the sale of tires or on the business, but he cannot, for that matter, he has to register. And this query has been raised by Mr. Ruchir Shukla. Suppose if the dealer, no, that is the query?
Yeah, that's the second question.
Suppose if the dealer is providing services to toll plaza, but as Ashit bhai has said, being a corporate, they will have to take the registration to discharge. So transporter is providing the services to toll plaza, that means IRB, I believe. Then in that case, since it's a corporate entity, then they will discharge the tax liability. Then third is, suppose if the, sorry, next one. Okay, so now the next issue would be, say for example, a recipient of the supply has discharged the tax liability under the reverse charge mechanism. So I have forgotten to take that part. Say recipient, say in this example, any registered person under the GST law has availed the services of transporter. Now the obvious thing is, at what rate of tax he has to discharge the tax liability? Under the rate of tax schedule, that means notification number, I believe 11/2017, it says that 5% tax has to be discharged, and with a condition that they are not eligible to take claim the credit of the same. So now here the liability to this is shifted from the service provider to service recipient.
So what rate of tax has to be paid? Whether still he has to follow that notification of rate of tax of 5%. In my personal view, yes, he can very well take the benefit of that notification and discharge the tax liability at 5%. So the next thing, whether he is eligible to take the standby credit of the same, yes, he is eligible because the debar of or the condition has to be complied by the transporter and not by the any other person. But the other school of thought is that, which says that no, 5% is applicable only if you are not eligible to claim the credit and not otherwise. So that means the recipient, if he wanted to avail the credit of that 5% credit, then he has to first discharge the tax at the full rate of tax, 18%, and then claim the credit of the same. So again, there are two school of thought. So as in the beginning, I have said that there is always a in reverse charge mechanism, everywhere two school of thoughts prevails.
Sumit has very rightly said that toll is exempted, so definitely he will not get the credit of the same. But this was from the overall perspective of the credit or to the recipient of the service. Then the next query is of Mr. Varshit Shah, no, Neeraj Agarwal, sorry. It says if X, a supplier, has supplied the goods to Y and transported that goods using GTA services and paid to GTA. Now X has to pay GST under RCM. Will the same be recovered for Y, or X has to charge GST to Y on the value he has added in the bill towards freight? Please clarify. So I believe it is like that supply, whenever a supplier is transporting the goods to his customer, at that point of time here, the recipient of the goods will say that you please transport the goods at my place or my factory premises and I will you charge the transportation charge into that. So the supplier will say 10 lakhs is the value of goods. On that the freight charge is say 10,000 rupees. So he will say 1 lakh rupees plus 10,000 is the transportation charge, which comes to 1,10,000. So now the issue would be that what rate of tax he has to levy. Whether he will say that on 1 lakh rate of goods has to be applicable, and on the transportation charges or a freight charges, it's a service transaction, so service tax rate would be applicable. Friends, here you have to see the concept of the composite supply. If you see the definition of composite supply, it says we have to see in that what is the principal supply. In this transaction, the principal supply is the supplying of the goods, and accordingly, the rate of goods would be applicable. So presuming the goods falling under 18% rate of tax, then on that 10,000 rupees, whole 18% needs to be levied. Now, when a supplier pays it to the transporter 10,000 rupees, at that point of time, Mr. Supplier has to discharge the tax liability under reverse charge mechanism on that 10,000 rupees and pay it to the government exchequer.
Yeah, Vikram. Whether he can raise a debit note, it's not charging.
In my view, just by splitting the invoice, you cannot say that this freight is not towards the principal supply, because the whole supply is one. Just because on the one hand you are saying that I am issuing the invoice for goods separately and for services separately, but you have only one PO, then in my view it would be difficult to say that one is for goods and one is for services and you have to levy the tax on the same thing. Sir, even in the VAT era, this was happening, and we are used to charge the tax on the whole amount. Yeah. Then this query is Mr. Varshit Shah. His query is, if I purchase any software from foreign website, do I have to pay IGST under RCM? Yes, you have to pay under ICM because you are availing the software is a service, and it would be covered under the any services. And you have to discharge the tax liability under close day, and you have to pay IGST on that. Then this query is of Mr. Rahul Sangani. He says, a private company, while reimbursing the telephone or other expenses of more than 5,000 to employee, do not account for GST already charged. Whether such expenses will be liable for... Rahul, I will just come to you within 5 minutes. Let me just come to that 5,000 ka exemption from an unregistered purchase person. Then I will come at that point of time.
Then this query is of Mr. Vishwas Bavishi. He says GTS service is availed by cooperative society and society is not registered. GTS service availed by cooperative society and society is not registered under GST. Then society will make payment to discharge the RCM liability. Yes, I have already told that there are two school of thought, and in my personal view, yes, society have to be registered whenever they are availing the services of a goods transport agency. Then this query is of Mr. Samir Kapadia. Oh, service is rendered by foreign agent towards procurement of export orders. Commission paid to such non-resident. Whether this will be treated as an import of service, whether RCM will apply. Samir, whenever we are saying that whether, first of all, whether it's an import or export, first of all, we have to see the location of the supplier and place of supply. Under the place of supply rules, if we go to section 13 of the IGST Act, wherein it says that in respect of an intermediary services, the place of supply would be the place of the supplier, location of the supplier. That means that the supply, undoubtedly that the place of location of the supplier and place of supply is in India, and therefore there won't be an export of services, and accordingly you cannot say that there is an import of services from that, and accordingly there is no question of any RCM liability. You have to pay the tax under forward charges. That's it.
Export, there is a foreign agent, no import.
Pardon?
The foreign agent is giving services to an Indian exporter.
Okay. Sorry, it's a reverse way. Sorry, Samir. Correct. So, Sumit has rightly drawn my attention that your question is that Indian exporter has appointed the agent overseas, and at that point of time, what would be the, whether it would be considered as an import of service and tax needs to be paid. Again, over here, the same principles or section 13 of the IGST Act will apply. Again, it will say the place of supply. Place of supply says the location of the supplier needs to be seen. Here, the location of the supplier is the foreign agent who is residing outside India, and accordingly, the transaction is not within the taxable territory. So, no tax is required to be paid under the reverse. Ultimately, by hook or crook, I have come to the correct answer. Then Amit Shah, sir, many suppliers not taking GST numbers since their turnover is below 20 lakhs and company taking services, and it is increasing hardship on company. So it is necessary for company to issue invoice and pay GST to government. Reverse charge ka hai? As URD, reply, URD. URD. Let me come to URD. I will do that. This query is from Mr. Jethalal Thakur. Sir, what if I am a composite dealer and I purchase from unregistered dealer? Do I have to pay tax under RCM? Sir, wait, I am coming to that provisions for unregistered. Now I will switch to the other provision. GST trading with an unregistered person. Most of the problem are with the unregistered persons. So now what would the situation? See, here the lawmaker or Prime Minister Modi has again played a very master stroke by incorporating the provisions that whenever a person, registered taxable person, procures the goods or services from an unregistered person, then the tax liability has to be discharged by the person who is a registered person. So previously what was happening? Before GST era, say under the excise law, the exemption limit was 1.5 crore. So what people used today to do, once that reaches to the turnover of 1.4 crore or 1.3 crore, they will stop their transaction. They will have another unit or another company in the name of so many people, our names are available in our country. So they will have the transaction in that company. Once there the turnover reaches to 1.3 crore or again 1.4 crore, they will stop the transaction and do the transaction in third company. And that's how the excise duty were evaded and people were not paying the excise duty. Similarly, under the service tax law also, or a VAT law, the exemption limit was 10 lakhs rupees. There also people were trying to manipulate by keeping themselves under a limit of 10 lakhs rupees and were not discharging the tax liability. So there was a tax base was at a very low level. Only 70 lakhs SSEs were registered out of a business population of 125 crores. See the ratio. Only this much people are doing the business. Rest all are not doing the business. I don't know how it will affect. So now it has been provided that whenever a person procures the goods or services from unregistered person, the registered person has to pay the tax. Now unregistered person means it will cover all kinds of person. Number one, if my turnover is less than 20 lakhs rupees, then if I opt that I don't wanted to do the compliance in GST law, I will remain unregistered. Then the person who has availed the goods or services from me, he has to pay the tax under reverse charge. Suppose if I am providing the services of exempted goods or services, then also the tax, then there is no issue. But suppose if I am providing any taxable services, then the person has to discharge the tax liability under the reverse charge mechanism by a registered person. So that is how here the legislation wanted to expand the tax base so that the maximum revenue can be come out of that. So this is the beauty of this unregistered person. Now let's say what the law says. So section 9.4 says that whenever a registered person, here in my example Jalgaon enterprise, procures the goods or services from this unregistered dealer, like say commission or a raw material purchase or a printing stationery, lodging and unloading, hotel expenses, then in that respect this Jalgaon enterprise, who is a registered taxable person, has to discharge the tax liability under reverse charge mechanism. Now, whenever he has to discharge the tax liability under reverse charge mechanism, he has to first issue the invoice to the unregistered person, and then after that he can avail the tax credit. All this documentation part we will come at a later date of time. So now it says any services or goods from an unregistered dealer. So now till now we understand that a businessman, when he procures the goods, naturally he will procure it from another registered person. But there are so many other goods or services which wherein the tax, the persons are unregistered. Say for example, loading, unloading. When a dealer is availing the services of a hathgari wala for loading and unloading activity, they are unregistered person. Then if you go to a chai wala in the office on the downstairs, there is a chai wala is there. You are taking the services of chai wala, availing the tea every day. Then he is an unregistered, you have to discharge the tax liability. If you are taking the Xerox of 1 rupee, then also that Xerox charges, it's a service transaction and you have to pay GST on that if that other guy is not registered. So now a major problem or a major hue and cry among the businessmen is that this unregistered dealer, because they have to undoubtedly take the services of this unregistered dealer in their day-to-day business. So now the government has come to their rescue. What says? It says we will exempt the intrastate supply of goods or services or both when received by a registered person from any supplier who is not so registered from the whole of central tax levyable thereon under the CGHP. So people were happy by reading the first paragraph. Yes, now whenever you are procuring the goods or services from an unregistered person, and if that transaction happens to be an intrastate transaction, it is exempt from tax. But then slowly they have inserted one proviso. It says that this exemption will not be applicable if the aggregate value of such supply of goods or services or both received by a registered person from any or all of the supplier who is or are not registered exceeds 5,000 in a day. That means now they have kept a limit of 5,000. That till 5,000, if you are availing the goods or services from any unregistered dealer in a day, then in that respect, you need not have to worry, sir, you need not have to discharge the tax liability. But moment it exceeds 5,000 rupees in a day, then you have to discharge the tax liability under a reverse charge mechanism. So now, every kind of problem will start. People were thinking, oh, so now I have to, they will say in a month, how many days? 30 days are there, 5,000 a day, so 1,50,000, mujhe aisa hi expense mil jayega, I need not have to worry. So, no, it's not like that, friends. Say, for example, you have a diary system of a chai wala. So chai wala, what every day will do, he will supply the tea and write the 10 tea to, has been consumed today. In the next day, another 15 tea, and in a month he will issue the invoice. And that invoice, if it happened to be a 5,000, and naturally you will record in after a period of 30 days, then this limit of 5,000 would not be counted. That one single invoice has to be counted. If you wanted to avail on a daily basis, then you have to pass the entry on a daily basis, that since it is a 5,000. Further, this limit of 5,000 would be applicable in a each state basis. So if a dealer is having a 30 office in 33 state, in all state he will have a limit of 5,000 rupees in a day, that would be applicable. Further, this limit of 5,000 rupees is applicable only in respect of intrastate transaction. That means if there is an interstate transaction is there, then no such exemption has been provided. So one has to be very much careful who are doing any interstate transaction. Let's see how it will help how to be calculated. Now I have just tabulated that if a type of inward supply from an unregistered supply is an intrastate, goods value owner in any day is 2,000 rupees, service value is 2,800, and exempted supply is 100 rupees. Then whether reverse charge would be applicable, it won't be applicable because the total of the taxable value is 4,800. Below 5,000 rupees, no reverse charge mechanism will be applicable. Then second, it's an intrastate transaction, value of goods are 5,000 rupees, there is no services, and exempt services are 4,200 rupees. Here also reverse charge mechanism will not be applicable because exempt service we need not have to be calculated, and you have to calculate only taxable value of goods. Here the value of good is 5,000, but the notification says exceed 5,000 rupees, so till 5,000 rupees you need not have to worry, no reverse charge would be applicable. Third situation, there is a supply of service in intrastate transaction, value of supply is 4,000 rupees, exempt supply is 1,500 rupees. Again, no reverse charge mechanism because my value of supply is only 4,000 rupees. Exempt supply need not to be considered. Then next transaction is an interstate transaction where my value of service is 500 rupees. Exempted supply is 300 rupees. So since this notification is only in respect of intrastate transaction and it doesn't cover the interstate transaction, so from 1 rupee, the reverse charge mechanism would be applicable, and under 500 rupees, under reverse charge mechanism, tax needs to be payable. So rest all are the same example are then, you can go through it. So the idea is that in respect of an interstate transaction, this benefit will not be available. So this is a flow chart of the thing. Yes, sir, I am coming to that. Your all questions, let me. So now purchases from an unregistered dealer, it could be a central or a local. Even a central, that means interstate transaction, any amount would be covered under the reverse charge mechanism. However, input credit would be available next month on the payment of the thing. If it is an intrastate transaction, that means local transaction, then no inputs. If the total of the value per day is more than 5,000 rupees, then reverse charge would be applicable and input tax credit would be available. If the total of one day is up to 5,000 rupees, no reverse charge and no tax paid is to be paid on such inputs. So this is the overall structure. Now, important thing, let's come into the ticket. Now, many times, if I have my offices in Ghatkopar and I have got one audit in Gujarat, so I have asked my employee to visit to Gujarat and do the auditing work. Now, while going and visiting the Gujarat, he has stayed in an hotel which doesn't have the GST number, and he has stayed over for 3 days and then came back, and then after coming from the Gujarat he has submitted the voucher of say 25,000 rupees towards his lodging, boarding and other expenses incurred during the audit period. Now naturally that hotel is an unregistered dealer, so he has not levied the tax. Being a registered dealer in the state of Maharashtra, now the question has come up, which tax I have to discharge? Whether I have to discharge the tax under the reverse charge mechanism, because under which law, under which state, under the CGST law or under the IGST law? Whether the transaction is an intrastate transaction, then I have to levy CGST or SGST, and if the transaction is an interstate, then IGST has to be levied. So naturally in the Gujarat, so again here the school of thought comes. first school of thought says that I need not have to pay the tax and the reverse charge mechanism. Why? Because the supply of services in the state of Gujarat, because in respect of the place of supply, if we go to the rule 12, which says that in respect of an immovable property, the location of the immovable property needs to be considered and the location of the supplier. So undoubtedly the location of supplier is in Gujarat and place of supply is also in Gujarat. So transaction is an intrastate transaction. Now in the state of Gujarat, Shah and Savla is not registered. So the first school of thought, no tax has to be leviable. Fine. Another school of thought, it says no, under the reverse charge mechanism, tax has to be levied. And here, since I am registered in the state of Maharashtra, so Shah and Savla has to discharge the tax liability as an IGST at the rate of 18% for that transaction. Wonderful. So I have discharged the tax liability under the reverse charge mechanism and I have discharged 18% IGST on that. Now the question will come up that in respect, if you are going in an hotel and avail the services in other state where you don't have resident, then in that respect, the credit would be lost. Suppose if that hotel is registered in Gujarat, then that hotel must have levied the local tax, that means Gujarat CGST and Gujarat SGST. Then in that respect, Shah and Savla could not able to claim the input tax credit of the state of Gujarat. Yes. But now suppose that hotel is unregistered and Shah and Savla is discharging the tax liability under reverse charge mechanism and discharging IGST. Now, IGST paid in the state of Maharashtra can be easily taken credit of the same. So, there is a lacuna in that. Really, no answer, clear-cut answer to that. Even this question has been raised before the RAC committee of the Commissioner of GST. But there also they said no answer to this. You have to levy IGST and take the credit because there is no other alternative to that. So, this all are the surprises in the as far as the... reverse charge mechanism is considered. Another problem would be that when a person goes on the field, say Gujarat, and incurs various expenditure, then what will happen? Now, whenever he travels through, how the input tax credit can be availed. Now, let's see how it can be availed. Whenever he travels from, say, Mumbai to Gujarat, say if he goes via train, then in that respect, whenever he procures the ticket would be in his personal name, and as I have told you earlier, the railway authority will not put the GST in, so that credit we will not pay. Then he has gone to the Gujarat and stayed in the hotel. In hotel, if that hotel is registered, then no credit is available because that hotel must be levying intra tax, local tax, that is local Gujarat CGST and Gujarat SGST, so that credit will not be there. Suppose if he stays in an unregistered hotel, then yes, we can claim the credit because Shah and Savla will pay IGST. So to that extent, I can enjoy the credit. Now suppose if he has gone there and consumed the meal over there, now what will happen when he is consuming the meal? At that point of time, again the same question will come. IGST or local tax would be there. So same situation would be there. Suppose he has availed the services of a transportation over there. The local transport is there, then in that respect, say local state government bus, then no tax is to be levied because on the local transportation of passengers by the state government, it is exempt from tax, so no credit would be there. But suppose if he's traveling again in AC coach or first class, again no credit because the state government will not levy the GST and such. So though in the whole situation, the tax has to be discharged under reverse charge mechanism, but the credit would not be possible to take. Though we are paying the taxes, but credit would not be available. This is how the whole situation would be in respect of when a person or a guy is going outside the on the marketing field and avails the various services outside the state. So these are the provisions as regards the unregistered person. Now, can we take the query of URD, sir Vikram Bhai?
Yeah,
please.
So there are two things. One, for that hotel, it will always be a CGST, SGST. It will never be an IGST.
True.
Okay. So even if he is unregistered and you step into his shoes, whatever tax he was supposed to pay, the same thing I am supposed to pay. So actually, I am not registered in Gujarat. So even the press release and the Twitter also says that you need not register.
Correct.
I mean, you not pay because both are unregistered in that state. That's one. But the second problem is those expenses are booked here in Maharashtra. Okay. Now, what will happen when I book it in Maharashtra? They will say that this is URD purchase. Your total URD purchase then increases by more than 5,000 rupees a day. Then you are back to square one. So your calculation of 5,000 will never match considering all these aspects.
Sir, that's why if you see in this slide, okay, you need not have to see 5,000. Think big. Otherwise, you will fail to do in every situation. It's very difficult to keep a tag or a control of this 5,000 rupees when you are talking about a big organization, right? So you have to think big and did not have to think about this planning of 5,000 rupees because it is a deceptive transaction. Very, let me put it in that manner.
And actually, if he is an unregistered dealer, he'll have to compulsory register because interstate supply is always compulsory and needs to be registered.
Correct. One more thing would be there. Now, I was wondering that, say, Shah and Savla will pay the IGST for that unregistered hotel. Then, in the while filing the return, he has to say place of supply is Gujarat. Otherwise, that Gujarat government will not get the revenue of that his share. Now, I am failed to understand how in the software all this information will be keyed in. See, on the one side, if the I have not come across any software which is saying that this is my place of supply. I have not come across any software. Tally hai ya koi bhi hai, pata nahi hai. Abhi jo entry kar raha hai, wo bande ko pata hi nahi hai ki ye place of supply kya hai. How will pass the entry and how will that will capture in the return? It's very, very nightmare. I am telling you to file the return. I am really telling you, friends, it's very nightmare to everyone how to compile all these details. But let's hope for the best. Let's see what will happen. Yeah. So any questions are there or shall I go ahead? Huh?
Just check. Those two questions I think you had parked.
No, that we can take it up, no?
That we can take it up. The two questions which you had parked.
Yeah. This is query of Mr. Rahul Sangani. Private company while reimbursing the telephone or other expenses more than 5,000 to employee do not account for GST already charged. Whether such expenses will be liable for RCM. So for taking the so telecom company, so they must be registered. How can they say?
The telecom company charged to you, but Shah and Savla never got GST. वो तो मेरे को एक बस दिखाएगा पूरा पैसा
दिखाएगा
हां दे चार्ज मी 1000 प्लस 180 जीएसटी आई क्लेम द रीइंबर्समेंट एज
1180
यू बुक 1180 बिल आपके नाम पे नहीं था वेदर यू हैव अगेन पेड द रिवर्स चार्ज
नो आई विल नॉट पे द बिकॉज़ आई दैट पेंडर इज ऑलरेडी रजिस्टर्ड सो हाउ डू आई डू दैट
ही इज नॉट रजिस्टर्ड तो
बड़ा हां बट इन रिस्पेक्ट ऑफ टेलीकम्युनिकेशन कंपनी दे आर ऑलवेज रजिस्टर्ड हां बिकॉज ही इज अ रजिस्टर्ड वेंडर इफ ही इज अनरजिस्टर्ड So nowadays we are advising. Nowadays we are advising our clients that whenever you, in respect of reimbursement of expenses, there are lot many things to be taken into consideration. So we are saying that you please give them allowance so that all these things will come go out of that. Though you may have to shell some more amount, but take it apart of the. But on the other side, the employee says, "Sir, I have to pay the income tax on that." But theek hai, itna kitna farak padne wala hai. Now this query is of Mr. Jethalal Thakur. Sir, what if I am a composite dealer and I purchase from unregistered dealer? Do I have to pay tax under RCM? Yes, every registered dealer, whether he is under composition scheme or under normal scheme, whenever he procures the goods or services from an unregistered person, he has to discharge the tax liability under reverse charge. Now you are in a more draconian condition, vicarious situation. Whatever tax you are paying, you are not eligible to take the credit of the same. So more problem would be there. Now Purushottam Tapde, whether RCM is applicable to local authority in respect of purchasing the goods through tenders. Local authorities, check government local authority when they are procuring the goods or service. But nowadays they are, no. exemption is when they are providing the services. So here exemption will not be there. But mostly nowadays, every government, whether it's state government or central government, order has been issued that you have to procure the goods or services from a registered person only, not from unregistered person. So that's why this. Next, Ruchil Shukla, in case of a restaurant opt for composition scheme, purchase material from unregistered person, then yeah, whether to pay GST as yes. he has opted for composition scheme, then he could not allow. Yes, he has to pay the tax and credit will be lost. Supplies from interstate unregistered person would be liable to RCM for a company. Yes, RCM would be there. Kalpesh Darya, whether registered person who procures any goods or services from an URD will have to pay tax. Supply exceeds 5,000 and when he will take the credit of such a tax in the same month or in the subsequent. I am coming to that query. Later on I have taken it. Don't worry. Then this query is of Mr. Amit Shah. In a company case like B2C transaction, if business receiving EMI from approximately 9,000 customers, so it is necessary to raise invoice customer wise and account separately in RCM or under GST. Sir, whenever you are raising, so it appears that you are into the finance lending of the money. So whenever you are receiving the EMI, at that time it would be of two components, principal amount and interest amount. In both the situation, both are under the exemption, so there is no issue. But whenever you are taking the processing fee, at that point of time you have to issue the invoice. But the point would be whether whenever he is supplying exempt service, because interest is an exempt service, then the law says that you have to issue, instead of tax invoice, you can issue the bill of supply. But for each transaction, either tax invoice or bill of supply has to be issued. Now this question on here. We are architecture. Naresh Mota. This is a query of Naresh Mota. Says we are architects. We purchase various items of stationery which has varying GST rates. How do I enter the bill? Through purchase book, through JV, then it will give tax analysis. See, whenever in respect of recording of the purchases, whether it's unregistered purchases from unregistered dealer or registered dealer, it is always advisable that all the entry has to be routed through the purchase register. Why it is necessary? Because while you are uploading the details in GSTR2, your inward invoices, at that point of time you have to give the details of your whatever goods or services which has been procured during that month. Now that means goods or services means that also includes the fixed assets also. So if you are routing the entry through your purchase register, then from the one single click you will get all the details. Otherwise it may so happen that you have to compile the details from two or three sources and then take it into consideration that what are the items which I purchased and I have to then bifurcate which are from registered and which are from unregistered. So it's always advisable in my view to record through purchase register. Then Parag Ved, conveyance expenses reimbursed to employee will be covered under reverse charge. Sir, definitely it would be covered under reverse charge, but provided first of all it has to be taxable, otherwise it won't be covered. So as I have told you earlier that if a reimbursement is for the purpose of transportation of passengers in a stage carriage, carrier pay, then in that respect it is exempted, so no need to pay the tax and the reverse charge. Suppose if you are availing the rent a cab services or from an Ola or Uber, then you need not have to pay under reverse charge because the tax liability is under the forward charge and Uber or Ola will pay the tax. Then suppose if you are availing the services of a rent a cab from a private organization, then in that case if he is unregistered, then you have to pay the tax under reverse charge mechanism. then RCM is applicable on ROC fees, tribunal appeal fees, etc. Sir, this ROC fees and tribunal appeal fees, specific exemption has been given in respect of a tribunal fees. So that is neither considered as goods, neither considered as services. In respect of when you are reimbursing the ROC fees, that would be again considered as a pure agent, and then on that you need not have to pay the tax on that under the reverse charge mechanism. Then again, this query is from Samir Kapadia. Payment made to services availed from a security guard board, whether covered under RCM, they are claiming that they are local authority and exempt. I don't think they are covered under the local authority. They are the private organizations, and they have to. We have to discharge the tax liability under reverse charge mechanism. Then Mr. Altaf Merchant, for services availed from entity registered abroad, but services provided in India, do we need to pay GST under RCM? This is an import of services, so you have to discharge the tax liability under reverse charge mechanism. Then Varshit Shah, sir, the exemption of rupees 5,000 is under CGST Act. So this exemption will apply under SGST Act as well. Yes, to the best of my knowledge, the under the SGST law, no separate notification has yet been issued. But there is some provision which says that whatever notification has been issued under the CGST Act, that would be verbatim applicable to the SGST Act also. So therefore, it would be applicable to SGST. So that's what I was trying to tell you in the beginning, that when you are reading the GST law, you have to read all the act in toto, IGST law, CGST law, SGST law, and then only come to the conclusion that what will happen to the particular transaction. Then this is Mr. Jethalal Thakur. Is it eligible to composite dealer to purchase from composite dealer? Yes, you can buy it from a composite dealer. Absolutely no problem on that. Right, sir? So now all this query has been answered.
Yeah.
So one more query. This is query from Shweta Ajmera. If payment made to transporter less than 5,000 in a day, then whether RCM is applied? See, this 5,000 rupees transaction is in respect of a procurement of goods or services from an unregistered dealer. Now, suppose if a transporter is a registered dealer, then in that respect, he will covered under the earlier notification of a special service. Now, again, here there would be a two things. What will happen that in respect of a notification number 13/2007, it says when a supplier of service is a GTA, then tax has to be discharged by the recipient of the supply. Then this 5,000 provision will not be applicable, and mandatorily this recipient of supply has to discharge the tax liability. Okay. Now let's go to the another period, time of supply. That means at what point of time the tax liability has to be discharged under reverse charge mechanism. Under the section 12, which deals with the time of supply of goods or services, wherein under the reverse charge mechanism the provisions has been made that at which point of time you have the person, registered person, has to discharge the tax liability. So in respect of goods, the law provides the time of supply shall be the earliest of, they when we say four situation. Let's see what, when the earliest of the four situation would be considered as a time, at that point of time your liability to discharge the tax liability would trigger. So which are those events? It says first of all, date of receipt of goods. Whenever you are receiving the goods, at that point of time you have to discharge your point of taxation will arise. Date on which payment is made. If there is no receipt of goods but you have made an advance payment of goods, then also my liability will trigger. So this is one of the unique characteristics of the GST law, which was previously not there under the VAT laws, that in respect of advance, the tax liability is now triggered. Under the earlier law, the VAT law, no such provisions were there. But now under the GST law, in respect of an advance payment, your liability would trigger. Then next situation, date immediately following 30 days from the issue of invoice by the supplier. Suppose if you have not received the goods, or you have not made the payment, but the supplier has issued the invoice, then the law said within 30 days from the issue of invoice by the supplier, one has to discharge their tax liability irrespective of the fact whether you have received the goods or not.
and last one in any other case, date of entry in the books of account of the recipient of supply. So what do you mean by date of entry in the books of account of recipient of the supply? Many a times this a question has come that suppose a journal entry has been passed, then what will be the provision? Now normally a journal entry is passed not in respect of goods, but normally it is in respect of services. So that we will separately take when we go to the service provision. So what do you, so in my view, what this provision says that whenever there is a separation in the transaction, at that point of time, if the person is caught, then they will say, and he doesn't have any record. So from the accounts of the recipient of the supply, the liability would be asserted. So in all these four situations, either first of all, date of receipt of goods or date of payment of which has been made, or date immediately within 30 days from the issue of invoice by the supplier, whichever date is earlier, one has to discharge the tax liability. That means, say for example, this is, we are in the month of August, and say that today, the 3rd of August, I have issued the invoice without issuing the goods, or I have not received the payment, then the recipient has to discharge the tax liability within 30 days. So 30 days has to be, it falls under 3rd of September. So my 3rd September, my liability trigger. So I have to discharge my tax liability on or before 20th day of October 2017. Somebody may raise a question, okay, what do you mean by 30 days? Whether 30 days has to be counted or full month has to be counted? Let's park it for the purpose of litigation, because there are so many judicial judgment which say 30 days means it has to be read as a month, and one has to take that thing into consideration. Now let us understand, take into consideration the services, time of supply when the services are provided. So here also three situations are provided. Number one, date on which payment is made. Number two, date immediately following 60 days from the issue of invoice by the supplier. And in any other case, date of entry in the books of account of the recipient. So here also the advance payment which has been made by the recipient, date need to be considered. Or date immediately following 60 days. If we see that in respect of goods, 30 days has been provided, but in respect of services, 60 days period has been provided. And in another case, date of entry in the books of account of the recipient. Here also, in my view, this talks about a situation wherein there is a separation in the turnover or the value of taxable services are there. But there are so many people who may take an interpretation that if a journal entry has been passed for making a provision of, say, audit fees, what will happen when my liability will start? Then you know that on 31st end of the year, that is 31st day of March of every year, our client will say, I am debiting the fees account because I have to book the expenses in my books of account. And so they will debit that professional fees and credit the auditor's account, and they will book the liability. So the question has come out whether that means I have to issue the make the payment of the same under the reverse charge mechanism, and presuming Shah and Savla is not a registered taxable person, what will happen? Friends, in my view, such kind of journal entry will not take hold good, because this is merely a provisional entry. Provision means I am anticipating that this would be the fees which would be charged by the Shah and Savla for carrying out the statutory audit. Further, while passing the journal entry for audit fees payable, one need not have to put the name of the auditor, though he has been appointment letter has been provided. You have to pass the entry audit fees account debit to audit fees payable account, and accordingly, no time of supply of service would not be triggered on that point of time. So this is what, but of course the second school of thought is always there, that yes, once you pass a journal entry, the liability would be triggered. But I am not subscribing to that view. Another situation, whenever transaction of supply of services entered with an associated enterprise where the supplier is located outside India, then in that respect, the law says date of entry in the books of account of the recipient or date of payment, whichever is earlier, one has to discharge your liability to discharge that tax liability would be triggered. So this is as regards the time of supply of the tax under the reverse charge mechanism. Now let's see what are the documentation and accounting to be done under the GST. Now first of all, the issuance of invoice. So whenever a registered taxable person
avails the services or goods or services from an unregistered person, then registered person has to issue a self-invoice so that a liability can be created in because he has to discharge the tax liability on behalf of the supplier. The law further provides that and gives the relief to the recipient that if he can have the option to issue the consolidated invoice at the end of the month in respect of all the goods or services received by him from the supplier who is not registered on the date of receipt of goods or services or both. That means what the person has to do that he has to pass all the entries of procurement or goods or services in his system or in his accounting software. Then at the end of the month, he has to identify which are the vendors which are unregistered, take the total of those vendor and issue one consolidated invoice record it in his books of account so that his liability would be created. This is provided under Rule 46 of the CGST Act. What is the invoice in which it has to be? It is the same invoice which you are issuing at the time when you are supplying the goods or services. So it says your GSTN number, details of the receiver you have to put, and normal description of the goods or services has to be put over there. One more problem which would cover over that, whenever you are procuring the goods or services from a general store or a departmental store and that store is an unregistered. So say for example you have purchased the groceries from office groceries from a general store and that general store is unregistered. Then various difficulties would come because you might be purchasing, say, aerated water, you might be purchasing wafers, you might be purchasing bread, you might be purchasing tea powder, sugar. So a dealer has to take into consideration the rates of all these items and then discharge the appropriate rate of tax on all this item, and that would really a great task on the dealer to understand that what kind of rate would be applicable on this all these supplies. Law further provides that registered taxable person, whenever he issues, makes the payment to the unregistered person, he has to issue a payment voucher. So payment voucher he has to issue whenever he makes the payment to an unregistered person. So what kind of voucher is there? Here the I have shown you the picture of that. It's merely a payment voucher, just a payment voucher we are preparing in a normal manner. Only the difference is that we have to put the every details like details of supplier, their voucher number, place of supply, description, and what is the taxable value, CGST, SGST, IGST, and amount payable on that. And we have to issue this payment voucher to the supplier at the time of making the payment. Now the important thing is how it will be captured in the return, because the law says that whenever you are procuring the goods or services from an unregistered person, whenever you are making the payment, you are eligible to claim the credit of the same. So whether how it will for to be taken in form number GSTR1 and GSTR2. Friends, whenever you are procuring the goods or services from an unregistered person, that will not form part of your GSTR1. That means outward supply mein wo nahi aayega. Theek hai? So a person may says that in table number 14, there are certain items which says that supply is attracting tax reverse charge basis. So if we go to the table number 4, wherein 4A says supply other than those attracting reverse charge, that means suppose if I am discharging, I am filing the outward supply for Shah and Savla, then whatever invoices has been issued, that I have to enter it in table number 4A. 4B may say supply attracting tax on reverse charge basis. So I am not a person who is to discharge the tax liability by someone else. So yahan kuch nahi aayega. But suppose the advocate is filing his return, then if he is registered, then he has to put the fill the table number 4B, that whatever services he has rendered on which the tax has to be discharged by under the reverse charge mechanism by the recipient, but he has to fill in this column. Then supply is made through e-commerce operator, RCM ya nahi aata hai. So table number 4B is for the supply attracting reverse charge mechanism. So only GTA, advocate, those 8 services which are mentioned in that notification number 12/2003, only uno ko any ko yahan 4B mein bharna hai, otherwise GSTR 1 mein kuch nahi bharna hai. Then registered taxable person when discharging tax liability under reverse charge mechanism, then details has to be filled in form number GSTR2. Do number pe return mein hume details sari deni hai. ठीक है कहां हम डिटेल देंगे वहां है टेबल नंबर 4 है व्हिच टॉक्स अबाउट इनवर्ड सप्लाई ऑन व्हिच टैक्स हैज टू बी पेड अंडर रिवर्स चार्ज तो 4A है इनवर्ड सप्लाई रिसीव्ड फ्रॉम अ रजिस्टर्ड सप्लायर अट्रैक्टिंग रिवर्स चार्ज दैट मींस के सपोज इफ शाह एंड सावला हैज अवेल्ड द सर्विसेज फ्रॉम एन एडवोकेट एंड दैट एडवोकेट इज रजिस्टर्ड देन दैट हैज टू बी पुट इन ओवर हियर एंड दिस वुड बी ऑटो पॉपुलेटेड फ्रॉम जीएसटीआर 2A You know that there is another form GSTR 2A है तो वहाँ वो fill up होगा तो यहाँ से ये auto populated होगा then 4B is there it is in respect of inward supplies received from an unregistered supplier that means whenever Shah and Savla has procured the goods or services from an unregistered person so this detail has to be put in manually over here so जितने भी है that I have to put it over here but again Since I have issued consolidated invoice, so only AK entry aayegi aur tax liability yahan ho jayegi. So this whole table number 4 yahan capture hoga supply attracting reverse charge mechanism. Then further in GSTR 1 and 2, main dena hai which are the documents issued during the tax period. Theek hai? So whenever we are issuing the invoice for inward supply from an unregistered person, we have to say कौन सा इन कितने इनवॉइस हमने इश्यू किए हैं फ्रॉम और टू उसका हमें अलग नंबर देना है कितने इनवॉइस हमने दिए हैं कितने कैंसल्ड किए और कितना नेट इश्यू किया है दिस डिटेल आल्सो नीड्स टू बी गिवन सो दिस इज समथिंग यूनिक थिंग सो आवर सॉफ्टवेयर शुड बी सच दैट देयर शुड बी इन अ पोजीशन टू कम टू गिव द रिपोर्ट और MIS रिपोर्ट ऑफ ऑल दिस थिंग तो ये क्या हमें और बता रहा है कि फॉर एवरी सीरीज ऑफ इनवॉइस वी हैव टू मेंटेन द सेपरेट सीरीज तो इनवर्ड सप्लाई के लिए वी हैव टू इश्यू अ सेपरेट इनवॉइस फॉर नॉर्मल आउटवर्ड सप्लाई वी हैव टू इश्यू अ सेपरेट सीरीज एंड वी हैव टू असाइन द नंबर्स फॉर दैट एंड दिस डिटेल नीड्स टू बी प्रोवाइडेड सो इफ यू सी ओवर हियर दैट फॉर 12 आइटम्स वी हैव टू गिव द डिटेल्स कितने बिल इनवॉइस हमने इश्यू किए हैं डेबिट नोट क्रेडिट नोट रिसिप्ट वाउचर पेमेंट वाउचर रिफंड वाउचर डिलीवरी चलन फॉर जॉब वर्कर डिलीवरी चलन फॉर सप्लाई ऑन अप्रूवल बेसिस डिलीवरी चलन इन केस ऑफ लिक्विफाइड गैस ये सारी चीज हमें देनी है एंड देन वी हैव टू फाइल द रिटर्न सो अगेन रिटर्न फाइलिंग टास्क इज अ टास्क बाय इटसेल्फ आई एम नॉट एबल टू गेस अप हाउ मेनी ऑफ अस वुड बी एबल टू फाइल द करेक्ट रिटर्न बिकॉज आई हैव नॉट कम अक्रॉस एनी सॉफ्टवेयर विच इज कम्प्लीट इन दैट मैनर दैट इज GST कंप्लायंट है Now the last thing, credit of tax paid under the RC reverse charge mechanism. सबका ये problem है इसकी credit जो भी reverse charge mechanism में भर रहे हैं कभी credit मिलेगी दो option है कभी credit मिलेगी either once you make the payment जिस दिन में मैंने unregistered person के पास से दिया है at that point of time tax has to be paid or at the time when I paid the tax. Now let us read the input tax credit rules. What it says. Section 16(1) says that every registered person shall, subject to such condition and restriction as may be prescribed and in the manner specified in Section 49, be entitled to take the credit of input tax charge on any supply of goods or services or both to him which are used or intended to be used in the course or furtherance of his business and the said amount shall be credited to the electronic credit ledger of such person. That means कि जो भी मैंने goods और services खरीदा है और उसके ऊपर I have discharged the tax liability, that will first of all go to my electronic credit ledger और वो credit ledger में जो भी amount है उसकी I can able to take the credit. Now it says input tax charge. So what do you mean by input tax charge? So it says IGST, which has been input tax has been defined under section 2, subsection 62. It says input tax means IGST including that on import of goods, CGST, UTGST and SGST charge on any supply of goods or services, tax payable under reverse charge mechanism, tax payable when supplies are procured from unregistered dealer, excluding tax payable under composition scheme. Ye composition scheme ka hame credit nahi milta hai, that's why uski credit bhi nahi milegi. So if you will look at it over here, ye jab bhi input tax credit mujhe eligible hai, toh first of all mujhe uska payment karna hai. ये पेमेंट नेचुरली वॉट एवर गुड्स और सर्विसेज हैज बीन प्रोक्योर्ड बाय रजिस्टर्ड टैक्सेबल पर्सन फॉर द मंथ ऑफ जुलाई वो उसकी टैक्स लायबिलिटी पे करेगा 20th अगस्त 2017 को
when that on 20th August 2017 jab payment kar diya to wahan se meri credit ledger mein jayega to credit ledger mein meri amount available hogi on 21st day of August 2017 so I would be in a position to avail the credit after 21st August 2017 only so that means it presupposes that the credit would be eligible only not in the month in which the bill has been booked but the month in which in the next month the credit would be eligible when it goes to the electronic credit ledger तो अभी दूसरा क्वेश्चन होगा ये जुलाई 17 में तो जीएसटीआर जीएसटीआर 1 और 2 है नहीं तो क्रेडिट कैसे होगी बट टैक्स हैज टू बी डिस्चार्ज एंड द रिवर्स चार्ज मैकेनिज्म तो अगस्त 20th अगस्त को टैक्स भरेंगे तो अगस्त मंथ में भी उसकी क्रेडिट नहीं मिलने वाली है सो टू दैट एक्सटेंट वर्किंग कैपिटल भी रुक जाएगा वन मोर प्रॉब्लम इज दैट जो भी हमारी क्रेडिट है ओपनिंग क्रेडिट है एज ऑफ 1st जुलाई 2017 दो दिस इज नॉट रिलेटिंग टू आरसीएम But I thought let me share with all of you. Jo 1st July 2017 ki credit hai, naturally that would be carried forward in GST era because wo meri return mein hai. To uske liye trans 1 form bharna hai. Trans form 1 bharne ki tarikh hai aur abhi credit ledger ready nahi hai. So that means whatever credit which is unutilized as on 1st day of July 17, वो मेरी इलेक्ट्रॉनिक क्रेडिट लेजर में जाएगी नहीं इलेक्ट्रॉनिक क्रेडिट लेजर में जाएगी नहीं तो मुझे उसकी यूटिलाइजेशन मिलेगा नहीं सो टू दैट एक्सटेंट अगेन आई हैव टू शेल आउट मोर अमाउंट तो मेरा वर्किंग कैपिटल बढ़ते ही जा रहा है सो नाउ बैंक के पास अभी रेट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट कम कर दिया है यस्टरडे आरबीआई पॉलिसी वॉज देयर विद दिस रीजन ओनली द रेट ऑफ टैक्स रेट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट हैज बीन रिड्यूस्ड सो दैट बिजनेसमैन कैन गो एंड आस्क फॉर मोर वर्किंग कैपिटल जस्ट ऑन अ लाइटर साइड दिस इज नॉट द केस सो ज्यादा से ज्यादा पैसा अभी लगेगा बिकॉज क्रेडिट नहीं मिलेगी दो तीन महीने के लिए ले और नॉट दो तीन महीने सपोज ये पोर्टल रेडी नहीं हुआ रिटर्न्स रेडी नहीं है तो पता नहीं कभी होगा लेट्स होप फॉर द बेस्ट कि ये सारा रेडी हो जाए अदरवाइज इट वुड बी वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू टेक द क्रेडिट ऑफ द सेंट फ्रेंड्स यहाँ ये मेरा रिवर्स चार्ज मैकेनिज्म का खत्म हो रहा है हाँ आई नो सुमित देर मस्ट बी सम क्वेरीज थ्री क्वेश्चन आर देयर Vishwas Bhavishi, in case of a reimbursement of expenses at a later date, then what would be the date or to be considered for RCM liability? I believe your question is that, say for example, for reimbursement, your employee has gone out of town, वहाँ उसने reimbursement किया in the month of July, but he has submitted the invoice in the month of, say, September. तो आपको कभी लायबिलिटी सो वेन एवर यू आर रिकॉर्डिंग इन योर बुक्स ऑफ अकाउंट एट दैट पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम योर लायबिलिटी बिकॉज एट दैट एट द टाइम ऑफ इश्यूएंस ऑफ इनवॉइस इवन यू डोंट नो सो यू हैव टू से दिस इज द डेट ऑफ रिसीप्ट ऑफ इनवॉइस ऑन द इनवॉइसेस जैसे आप टीडीएस में करते हैं डेट रिसीप्ट ऑफ इनवॉइस लेट मिल रहा है तो यू पुट अ डेट ऑफ रिसीप्ट तो आपकी लायबिलिटी बच जाएगी Next is Varshit Shah. Invoice number of self invoice should be in line with serial number of sales invoice. नहीं ये जरूरी नहीं है. You can have to compulsory admit two series. One is for your normal outward sales invoice and one for the self invoice under the reverse charge mechanism. जो मैंने आपको अभी यहाँ बताया table number 13 में आपको detail करनी है. Next query is of Deepa Murjani. If a person provides professional services to a sole proprietorship firm, what the concern need to pay under reverse charge? Is there any option wherein it can be avoided? If a person provides professional services to a sole proprietorship firm, I believe sole proprietorship firm is a registered and a professional, you are not registered, then sole proprietorship firm has to pay the tax. Only the problem will not be there if you are also unregistered and that sole proprietorship firm is also unregistered. Then you need not have to worry. If both are unregistered, then no reverse charge mein tax nahi bharna hai. So that means hame aisa hi karna hai. Unregistered, unregistered ke saath service provide karo, no tax. Then Jethalal Thakur, RCM has to be paid on import as well as on export. Import pe bharna padega, export pe kya?
Export IGST
अच्छा आप बता रहे हो एक्सपोर्ट वेन एवर यू आर एक्सपोर्टिंग गुड्स और सर्विसेज आप आईजीएसटी भरोगे तो उसका रिफंड मिल जाएगा बाकी अदरवाइज नहीं दैट इज नॉट रिवर्स चार्ज मैकेनिज्म इज देयर एनी प्रोविजन इन द एक्ट फॉर गुड्स सेंट ऑन अप्रूवल बेस्ड ऑन चलन सर दिस क्वेश्चन इज नॉट इन रिस्पेक्ट ऑफ आरसीएम Definitely, yes. You can issue the challan and send the goods on approval basis. I think sari queries curly hai. Now it's time that I should thank the chamber to provide me an opportunity to share my views on reverse charge mechanism, most controversial topic. And I hope that now everyone is ready with the GST. Real implementation has started. And thank you very much to all of you for the patience listening. Thank you.
I should thank profusely to Ashit bhai for having taken us through all these nitty-gritties and spent his valuable time over here explaining us all the minutest details and going through the various provisions and the manner in which you will get the credit, you will not get the credit, multiple views which are there on the same particular issue. We thank you very much, Ashit bhai, for being here. And it was an honor to have you over here. Thank you very much.
Now we can unmute the session and people can.